a person who prays every day has the following task and challenge they have to deal with, which is praying in a foreign language. And what I mean by that is ancient Jewish Hebrew, Lashon HaKodesh. And the Shulchan Aruch and, you know, many great Jewish sources say it's the holiest language, and it's the world was created by Hebrew, according to a Midrash. So I want to ask you, is praying in Lashon HaKodesh Hebrew the ideal? Because there are other rabbis, such as Rabbi Nachman, who was very famous for telling his students, you should pray in Yiddish, you should pray in your mother tongue, because it's more intimate and more personal, and to use a word that you like, it's authentic. So in your opinion, Rav Cardoza, who's been praying for, you know, many, many years, how do you see prayer at its highest level? Is it in Lashon HaKodesh, in ancient spiritual Jewish Hebrew, or is it in your mother tongue?
Yeah, thank you. Let me start by saying, on a personal level, I pray in Hebrew, but I also pray in Dutch and sometimes in English. Depends on my mood. It depends on what I want to say. And when I feel that one language reflects better what I want to say than another language, then I will make use of that language. I don't have any doubts that God understands all the languages. But there is something special about Hebrew. And that is that I have a feeling, I cannot prove this, that the words in Hebrew go deeper than in Dutch or in English. Why that is, I'm not sure about. Some people will say it is because it is the oldest language in the world and God used the language when he created the world, whatever that means. But it works a little bit like rituals. A ritual, we do certain things which are external, making kiddush, doing other things like the lulav, what else it is that we do, and we are very much a doer religion. The meaning of this is that a ritual can get to something which there is no other way to get there, in our hearts, in our deepest emotions. In other words, while it is external, it touches on something deep down there, which I do not know how to reach that in any other way. Now, once more, I can't prove that, but I have a feeling that this is true. I have also a feeling that this is true about Hebrew, that there is something about this language which scientifically cannot be proven, where when I say it in Hebrew, it touches somewhere where English will never get, and where Dutch or any other language will never get. That's also the reason why it is incredibly difficult to translate Hebrew prayers in another language. You know, Martin Buber, together with Franz Rosenzweig, they translated the Chumash, which is quite a impressive work, which they did because they tried to get to the Hebrew and still put it afterwards into German. And by the way, if you have a look in the German of Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, the famous Rav Hirsch, Rabbiner Hirsch, you will see how much this is similar to the translation of Martin Buber and Rosenzweig. It gets totally lost in English. That's so interesting. Perhaps there is something in German or better, because they were such masters of the German language, Martin Buber and Rosenzweig, and the Rabbiner Hirsch, that they knew how to do that. I don't know if there's anybody else today anymore who can do that as well as they did. I'm always impressed by these translations. So from that point of view, I see that Hebrew, yes, there is something. There is something there which is kadosh, which is holy. It is called the Lashon HaKodesh. It is the holy language. German, Dutch, English is not a Lashon HaKodesh. And there is something to say for that. At the same time, you also lose out. And that is that often you say things which you don't even know how to translate them. into your own language, let's say, or whether it is English or Dutch, you don't understand the Hebrew. If you go to some of the Selichot, especially in the Ashkenazi world, which we say between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, they're nearly untranslatable. I sometimes look into the translations and then I realize that the Hebrew is easier to understand than the translations. And this is a problem. I have to tell you a little story here. When I started to learn on my own a little bit of Gemara for the first time in my life, I used a German translation. At the time, there was no English translation. There was not even Sonsino yet. And so there was a German translation, I forgot the name of it, and I had bought it, and I started to read it. At a certain moment, there's a whole piece in Latin, and not in German. And I wondered, why is this in Latin? So I know a little Latin, and it took me a little bit of time, and then I realized what happened. That piece of the Talmud, they didn't dare to translate into German. Why? Because it was about the question, how does a woman make her husband to desire her? And the Talmud discusses that. And that is so graphic in the way as it happens, that the German translators were probably, they became red in their face, that they translated it in Latin, because who would know Latin? Because I knew a little bit of Latin, I realized what had happened there, and that is very typical. You know, if you walk around in a yeshiva and you hear what people are discussing, very often about Petach Patuach and things like that, which are very sexual, right? Nobody, when he is learning it, thinks in these terms, but it is sexual. And that is so typical, and you can only do that in Hebrew. The moment you would translate it in English, you would really get red in your face. I find that fantastic, to be quite honest, because it shows the kedusha of learning in Hebrew or Aramaic, whatever it is. But indeed, you also lose out, because there are certain parts of the prayer book which you just don't understand, like in the case of the Selichot. Or even Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, there are parts which are very difficult to understand. The Hebrew is so elevated, and the poets who wrote this a few hundred years ago in Spain and Portugal and also places in Germany, their knowledge of Hebrew was much greater than we have anything. So for me, it has little meaning, because I don't know what it means. So I learned something, and I sometimes use that. There was a Rosh Hashiva, in Manchester, a Haredi Rosh Hashiva. I think his name was Rav Siegel. Tremendous tzaddik. Louis Jacobs writes about him in his autobiography. Rabbi Siegel was a highly unusual holy man. But when he prayed, and I understand, and I hope I tell the truth, even when he said the bracha, he said, Baruch, and then he said in English, blessed. Ata, you. Hashem, God, and so on. So it took him twice as long to say all the prayers. But he did that because he was afraid, he was English born, that he would not understand it properly into Hebrew, and he felt the need to translate it into English. And I haven't heard anybody else doing that, but no doubt this can be very helpful, and that is what I sometimes do to make it myself a little easier. But it indeed means that you pray twice as long, because it helps in that way to concentrate on the prayers. This is one of the reasons why I often do no longer go in the weekdays to the synagogue, because it goes too fast. But when I'm at home and I pray there, I can do this on my own speed and, my own feelings and emotions. So this is the other side of the story. So to me, Yes, I try to pray as much as possible into Hebrew because I believe it touches me somewhere, which I can't explain, but it does something to me, right? And at the same time, I sometimes say, I need to say this in another language, or I do what Rav Siegel did, and I translate word by word from Hebrew into English or Dutch, whatever it is.